Hello students, I am Dr. Guneet Bhojani here and welcome to this session on overview of infertility. Now, infertility is a very, very important topic for all the students. If you are a final MBBS student, you get a long answer, you get a short answer, and in your gynecology case also, it's a very, very commonly asked, you can get case on male factor, female factor. And of course, if you are a PG entrance aspirant, then all the entrance exam, All India, AIIMS, DNB, whichever exams, extremely important topic, at least 2 to 3 MCQs can be expected on this topic overall of infertility. So it'll be one on male factor, one on female factor. So I'm going to give you an overview in this 30-minute sessions, how all, what all things can cause infertility. It's just going to be an overview of all the conditions and important aspects of infertility. Okay. So moving on, how do I define infertility as? Okay, so infertility, how do I define infertility as? Yes, many students tell me, sir, not able to conceive. That's correct, but that's only partly correct. After how many years of marriage? Yes, anybody, all of you, after how many years of marriage? They say, even after 1 year of marriage. Okay, all of you wrong. Why? Because marriage since is not important. Please pay attention. A couple may be married for 5 years. Example, couple may married for 5 years, but husband is using condoms, wife is using birth control pill, and again, that's not infertility. Husband is in one part of India, wife is another part of the country, and they are not staying together, then that's again not infertility. So please don't get fooled, because a very common mistake, they ask you in a viva also, and students make a mistake in this, that they say, sir, not able to conceive after 1 year of marriage. No. Or in your MCQ also this is asked, that not able to conceive after 1 year of marriage, any student mark that, that is wrong. Okay, so please pay attention. Infertility is defined as inability to conceive in spite of 1 year of regular unprotected intercourse. So 1 year criteria is correct, but marriage since is not important. I repeat, infertility is defined as inability to conceive in spite of 1 year of regular unprotected intercourse. Okay, each and every word is important. Regular unprotected intercourse, and after 1 year also the couple is not able to conceive, then we label the patient as infertility. Now this infertility is of two types. It could be primary infertility and secondary infertility. What is the difference? Please pay attention. Primary infertility means that the female has never been able to conceive. She has not yet conceived ever in her life, then we call it as primary infertility. Suppose she has conceived once and now she is not able to conceive again, then we call it as secondary infertility. Please understand, whatever may be the outcome of that first pregnancy could have been a live baby, dead baby, she could have landed up with an abortion, she could have wanted an MTP. Doctor, I don't want a baby now. She could have gotten an MTP at that time and now she is not able to conceive. So irrespective of the outcome of the first thing, if a patient have conceived once, if she has conceived once and now not able to conceive again, now not able to conceive, then we call it as secondary infertility. Okay, I repeat, the first baby could have been a live baby, they could have been twins, it could have been one baby, two baby, it could have been boy, girl, that does not matter, it could have been a dead baby, or it could have been an MTP, or it could have been an abortion, or it could have been a spontaneous miscarriage, that is not important. So if the patient has never been able to conceive, that is called as primary infertility. Able to conceive once and now not able to conceive again, that is called as a secondary infertility. Now obviously we know that we have got male, either the male can have a problem, the female can have a problem, combined causes can also have a problem, and lastly unexplained infertility. I'll discuss all that, I'll tell you what all this. Okay, so what can have a problem? Obviously all these things, and in individually what we can will also play will tell you important. Okay, now roughly the female factors. Okay, so female can have a problem roughly around 40 to 50% of the time. Okay, when a couple, we may consider infertility. Okay, the male partner can have a problem in roughly 30 to 40% of the time. Again, combined, both around 30% of the time, husband wife both can. So even if you remember 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, exact figures you need not remember. Even if you remember 30 30 30, fair enough, not a problem at all. And unexplained 10%. What is the meaning of unexplained? That all possible investigations, right? Because we are not God, so all possible investigations are normal. That means husband is also normal, wife is also normal, still they are not able to conceive. Why? We do not know. So all possible investigations are normal, and that is unexplained infertility. That means there is no obvious cause found out. There is no obvious cause found out. That will be roughly around 10% cases. Okay. So this is a rough overview. These are rough figures, which is not expected for you to remember, but just keep this in mind. Now, very, very important. This definition, 1 year, everybody knows that's an inability to conceive in spite of 1 year of regular unprotected intercourse. But why 1 year? Why 1 year? Nobody teaches you at MBBS level. And MCQ was also asked recently on this topic that yes, sir, infertility is 1 year, but why 1 year? Now, please pay attention. The egg in the female survives for 24 hours. And the sperms of the male partner can survive inside her for say 48 to 72 hours, mainly 48 hours. So mainly in the whole month, I'll tell you how the ovulation takes place and which hormone is responsible for ovulation. But mainly the female is fertile 1 to 2 days on either side of ovulation. Now I just want you to take a wild guess or a wild figure. You might be right, you might be wrong, no problem. If the husband is perfectly normal and the wife is perfectly normal, H is husband, wife is W is wife. If the husband is absolutely normal, wife is absolutely normal, and they have intercourse at the time of ovulation. What am I saying? Husband normal, wife normal, sex at the time of ovulation. Egg and the sperm just dying to meet each other. Okay, anybody, what is the chance of pregnancy in that 1 month? Yes, anybody, whatever number comes in your mind, 1 to 100, 100 options in front of you. Understand the scenario, husband normal, wife normal, intercourse at the time of ovulation. Sex at the time of ovulation. What is the chance of pregnancy? Yes, anybody? Yes, 60%, 70%, 90%, 69%. Nice number, okay? But please pay attention. Even if the husband is absolutely normal and the wife is absolutely normal and they have intercourse at the time of ovulation, the success in 1 month is at the most, only 10 to 15%. I jokingly tell all my students that it only happens in Ekta Kapoor serial and Hindi picture where hero, heroine meet and heroine pregnant in the first shot itself. Okay? Why? Because this is nature. If every month the female starts conceiving, instead of 7 billion people, will be 70 billion people on planet Earth. Can I come matlab kya? There's anyway population explosion, will be a huge explosion. What am I trying to say is that even if everything is normal, in one particular month, only roughly 10 to 15% couple can achieve a pregnancy. But this is cumulative. Don't remember these figures, but by the end of 6 months, roughly 50% couple, and by the end of 1 year or 12 months, roughly 90% couple will be able to achieve a pregnancy. So what am I trying to tell you is that even if everything is normal, the couple may take 3 months to 6 months to 9 months to 1 year to achieve a pregnancy. So just if in 1 month they are not able to conceive, no problem. There's no problem. Okay. So by the end of 6 months, around 50% couple, and by the end of 12 months, 90% couple will be able to achieve a pregnancy. By the end of 12 months of or 1 year of that, yes, regular unprotected intercourse is understood. And at the end of 1 year of regular unprotected intercourse, 10% couple will still remain infertile. And those are the ones whom I'm supposed to investigate. And then I start investigating the male and the female together. It's understood. So this they can ask you in a Viva also, that doctor, 1 year infertility definition, yes, 1 year, but why? That sir, by 90% of the couple, by the end of 1 year, 90% couple will be able to achieve a pregnancy, 10% will still remain infertile, and only those are the ones whom I am supposed to investigate. And then we start investigating where, why, what is the problem. And this 10% was an MCQ in one of, I'm so happy I teach this every year in my lecture, and this 10% was an important MCQ in one of the entrance exam. That at the end of 1 year, the MCQ asked was, at the end of 1 year, what is the percentage of couple likely to remain infertile in spite of regular unprotected intercourse? 10%, because 90% will be able to achieve a pregnancy. So what am I saying is, that if in 2, 3, 4, 5 months time the patient has not been able to achieve a pregnancy, don't start investigating early. Why? Because if you start investigating early, the stress goes up, and with stress the further success goes down. So if the couple has not conceived in 3, 4, 5 months time, there's no panic. They may conceive in the remaining 5, 6 months time. Okay. So virgin MCQ for all of you. Now virgin MCQ is my terminology, my specialty. It simply means brand new MCQ. That means MCQ is not asked till now in the entrance paper, but will come for sure in the future exams, is coined by me as virgin MCQ. So virgin MCQ for all of you, husband comes to you and says, doctor, I am married for 4 months. I know what is the fertile period of my wife. we are having sex on that particular day, my wife is not becoming pregnant, please investigate. The answer is, don't investigate. You just have to tell him, relax, abhi khali 4 mahina hua hai, go back home, enjoy. If after another 8 more months also your wife is not becoming pregnant, then you come back to me and then I will evaluate both of you. Why? Because if you start evaluating early, the stress goes up, and with stress the further success goes down. So all this is very, very important. Definition of infertility, primary infertility, secondary infertility. In 1 month around 10-15% can achieve a pregnancy, and by 12 months 90% couple will be able to achieve a pregnancy, and 10%. So all this could be asked to you in your exams. Okay. Now, moving on first to the female factors and then on the male factors. So all of us is logic, all of you look on the board. This is the uterus, this is the cervix, this is the vagina, this is the fallopian tube. Okay, and then here is the ovary. Okay, and just recap, all of you know that the male partner inserts deposits the sperm in the vagina. Uske baad Olympic ka race shuru hota hai, all the sperms try to go above, the ovulation takes place, the egg comes from here, but only one of the sperm gets the gold medal, which is to fertilize the egg. Okay, and then the embryo, egg and the sperm unite in the fallopian tube. That's again a very famous MCQ. Fertilization takes place in the fallopian tube, remember FF. Okay, FF. So fertilization, fallopian tube, this has been asked. Okay, in the ampullary part of the fallopian tube. Okay, please pay attention, very important. And then the embryo will travel, and then finally the implantation will take place in the uterus. Okay, so implantation is in the uterus. So don't get confused. This question came, many students got confused. Okay, it's very simple, but student, in the heat of the exam, you can make a mistake. So fertilization, fallopian tube, implantation, uterus. So from the picture, you know that for the husband, we know, we'll discuss that the semen analysis, SA is a short form for semen analysis, should be normal. We'll discuss that what all parameters we look at. And for the female to conceive, remember mainly three things. She should be ovulating, the ovary should be functioning normally, the fallopian tube should be normal, and of course the uterus or the cavity should be normal. Okay, so mainly, yes, overall her health is important, but overall when we look at the causes, it could be ovarian causes, it could be fallopian tube causes, or it could be your uterine factors. Okay, so it could be ovarian factor, fallopian tube factor, and uterine factors, which are mainly very, very rarely the cervical factor, cervical stenosis, and antisperm antibody in the cervical mucus. All that is very, very rare. So even if you remember the three main things, that should be enough. Okay, now 2-3 points, very, very important, please pay attention. Worldwide, this ovarian factors. What are the ovarian factors? I'll tell you. Basically, ovarian factors means what? That the female is not able to ovulate. Okay, so mainly anovulation. AN is my short form for anovulation. Okay, why you cannot ovulate? There are various reasons, but I'll discuss one or two important. So worldwide, this is the most. Okay, around 30-40% of the time, it is going to be the ovulatory factor. Okay, 30-40% of the time the ovulation will be defective, ovulation will not be taking place. So worldwide, that is the most common cause of female infertility. If they ask you very important MCQ, what is the most common cause of female infertility worldwide, then remember this, ovarian factors. But in and followed by fallopian tube number one. I'm talking of worldwide ovarian factor number one and fallopian tube number two. What is fallopian tube factor? Yes, the tube could be blocked because of the adhesions. Okay, there could be fibrosis, adhesions. So common sense, you can see over here that the sperm cannot come, egg cannot come, so tube could be blocked because of the adhesions. Okay, so tube could be blocked because of the adhesion. So fallopian tube is again roughly around same 30-40%. Okay, so worldwide ovulatory factor, it's almost the same number wise, but just pay attention that worldwide ovulatory factor is the most number one, followed by fallopian tube blockade. Could be what? Yes, gonococci infection, chlamydia infection, genital tuberculosis, adhesion, fibrosis, endometriosis, all that condition. Okay, but remember, in India, because the infections and genital tuberculosis are more common, in India it is the other way around. Fallopian tube or the tubal factors are the most common, number one, followed by ovarian factor number two. Okay, So please keep in mind that whenever I look at the female factors in India, and this is only for your MCQ purposes, and they will specify, okay, don't bother, okay. So in India, tubal factors are the number one. Tubal factors, that means the fallopian tube is blocked because of whatever reason, gonococci, chlamydia, tuberculosis is number one, followed by my ovulatory problem, okay. Ovulatory problem, that is my ovarian factors. Okay, ovarian factors. This is in India. We are talking as the leading cause of infertility. And just exactly overall worldwide, exactly ulta, worldwide this ovulatory factor becomes number one and this tubal factor will become number two. Okay, so worldwide ovulatory factors are the most common cause or the leading cause of infertility, followed by fallopian tube blockage or tubal factors. In India, the other way around, tubal factors are the most common. So again, this is very, very important. This could be asked to you in your exams. Okay, now what could be the ovarian factor? Anybody, what could be the ovarian factor? Yes, what could be the ovarian factor? Yes, so please pay attention. What could be the ovarian factor is that basically no ovulation, an ovulation. Okay, female is not producing egg, an ovulation. So what could be it? Yes, the most leading cause. Yes, many causes can lead to an ovulation, thyroid disorders, high prolactin level, but the most important, yes, PCOS, polycystic ovarian disease or polycystic ovarian syndrome. Okay, or polycystic ovarian, PCOS or PCOD, okay, that is the leading cause or the number one cause for an ovulation. It's a very, very common condition and it's a misnomer, even though the name cyst is that they're not actual cyst in the ovary, they're small follicles, which I discuss in detail in my PCOS lectures. Okay, so either the patient is not ovulating because of PCOS or other causes of an ovulation like thyroid disorders, prolactin disorders or your stress, all that. Or there could be, please pay attention, as the age advances, common sense 30, 35, 40 years, as the age advances, the ovarian function keeps on dropping down. Yes or no? Yes, normal. And common sense, when you reach 40, 45 years and above, there is menopause. Ovary stop functioning permanently. Okay. So basically what am I saying is that in females, 20, 25 till 30 years, the fertility is very good. After 30 years, the fertility starts dropping down. And after 35, still further drops between 35 to 40. Why? Because the eggs are getting depleted. So basically, because every month the female is losing the eggs. So as your age advances, if this is the age, the ovarian function is going to decline. So there could be a condition or diminished ovarian reserve. Very difficult. Not expected at MBBS level, but what is DOR? Decrease ovarian reserve. What is the meaning of ovarian reserve? Ovarian reserve simply means your bank balance. Okay, ovarian reserve means simply means what is the functional capacity of the ovary to produce eggs. Okay, that means when you are young, 18, 20, 25, you've got lots of bank balance, you've got lots of many eggs in you. Okay, and as your age will advance, your bank balance, ovarian reserve will keep on becoming less. And when actually completely all the ovarian reserve is over, that means all the eggs are depleted, you reach menopause. MP is short form for menopause. Common sense. Okay. So this decreased ovarian reserve or diminished ovarian reserve could be either naturally occurring. Naturally occurring means at the age of 40, 45 years. Okay. So it could be naturally also. Diminished ovarian reserve could be naturally also. And diminished ovarian reserve could be also premature also. It could be premature ovarian failure also. Okay. That very, very sad, very, very rarely that premature ovarian failure. That means what? The doctor, patient is only 35, 38, but ovaries stop functioning. Okay. So it is called as premature ovarian failure. So when the ovaries stop functioning even before the age of 40 years, when menopause occurs less than 40 years, it is called as premature ovarian failure. Okay, so basically I repeat, the ovulatory factors could be either there is no ovulation taking place because of PCOS or the eggs are getting depleted and naturally because as the age advances, not only quantity, even quality. So old patients have difficulty in conceiving. Why? Old patients, 39, 40 years have difficulty in conceiving because both are quality and quantity of egg is defective. Okay, because as you age, the oocyte quality and quantity both will decrease. And that is why just for your reference, When you see today in the ads in the newspaper that a 45-year-old lady conceived, 50-year-old lady conceived, that is not generally with their own eggs. That is always with a donor egg, because when your eggs have reserved, when your eggs have diminished, when you do not yourself have got egg, egg donation. Like how in sperms, Wiki Donor movie had come, sperm donation, similarly there is also egg donation. Okay. So if the 45-year-old lady may want to conceive and all that, she might require a donor egg from young healthy donor, because otherwise her eggs are diminished or not good quality and quantity. Okay, so I repeat, the ovarian factors are either anovulation, which is PCOS, very important, or there is a diminished ovarian reserve. Ovarian reserve is becoming less. Okay, natural menopause, or it could be a premature menopause. Okay, so that is your ovarian factors. Now, what could be, so that's the overview. Okay, now what could be the tubal factors? Yes, tubal factors could be all our infection, gonococci, chlamydia, genital tuberculosis, or externally. Okay, there's a lot of fibrosis adhesions. Okay, sometimes in PID, yes, pelvic inflammatory disease. Okay, the tube is blocked because of fibrosis adhesion. In endometriosis also, there's a lot of fibrosis and adhesions in the pelvis. So the tube will get blocked. That is the tubal factor. I repeat, it could be gonococci, chlamydia, and in India very commonly even, yes, genital tuberculosis. And acute PID, chronic PID will lead to episodes of scarring of the fallopian tube. And yes, luckily, but we have got two tubes. So if one tube is also normal, patient can conceive. I jokingly tell all my students, one tube is enough to cause population explosion. Okay, that means if both the tubes are blocked, then there's going to be a problem. Obviously, all this infection would lead to damage to both the tubes. Okay, so both the tubes could be blocked or damaged. Okay, or sometimes if a tubal ligation has been undergone, then again that's a tubal factor. And if you want to marry again and have babies more, then we have to do a TL reversal if a tubal ligation or tubal fallopian tube sterilization operation has been done. But mainly remember, your infections are going to play a role over here in tubal factor and any other adhesions externally. Okay, now common sense, all of you please pay attention. This is our pitch. This is our pitch, the uterus. Here the implantation is going to take place, yes or no? This pitch has to be normal. This pitch has to be normal. So suppose there is a fibroid, there is a fibroid within the cavity of the uterus, or there is some big polyp, or there are intrauterine adhesions, yes, intrauterine adhesions, or there is a big septum, all that can cause infertility. Okay, so these are our uterine factors. Okay, I repeat, intrauterine adhesions or a polyp or a fibroid or a septum, all that can cause, contribute to the uterine factors. Why? Because the cavity has to be normal for the pregnancy to take place and implantation to take place. Now please understand this. I'll teach you when I take my lectures on fibroids. All fibroids will not cause infertility. Suppose there is a chintu, 2 cm fibroid outside the uterus, that is not going to cause any problem to the patient. Patient can easily conceive. So remember, fibroids which distort the cavity. So a large intramural fibroid which is protruding into the cavity, or a submucosal fibroid. Okay, a submucosal fibroid, or it's more of a fibroids will distort the cavity, then the implantation will not take place. Okay, suppose there's a fibroid here, that is not going to cause any problem. You need not even treat it and patient will have no problem at all. Okay, and intrauterine adhesions. Okay, intrauterine adhesions is also called as Usherman syndrome. Okay, Usherman syndrome. So all this is basically the overview of the various factors which are going to cause the infertility in the female. I repeat, ovarian factor, tubal factor, uterine factors could be submucosal fibroid, polyp, intrauterine adhesions, that is your Usherman syndrome, which can happen because of repeated curettage or genital tuberculosis, and fibroids which distort the cavity of the uterus. Remember that all that will cause our uterine factors. Cervical factor is very rarely there could be a tight cervical stenosis. All that can be easily taken care by doing IUI, or there could be antibody in the cervical mucus which will kill the sperms. That could again be again be taken care of by doing IUI. Okay, so I'll give you the overview of the treatment also, what needs to be done and how you need to be done. Okay, now for the female, for the male factor, very very important, what we need to keep in mind is that the semen analysis. Okay, so please pay attention, this is something very very new. The things have changed that in the olden days before, okay, so this is the as per the WHO, actually it is 2010 guidelines, but many students are still not aware, so please keep in mind the old criteria, that minimum sperm count. Yes, anybody, what should be the normal sperm count? Yes, 50 to 150 million, very good. So agar 50 million 100 million Superman hai to very good, okay, because 100 million is considered Superman, but minimum. Okay, so the old criteria was that at least 20 million per ml should be the sperm count. 20 million per ml or more is understood, or more. Okay, but this is the old criteria. Now the new criteria, remember that it is only 15 million per ml. Obviously this is the lower limit of normal, or more is understood. So please keep this in mind, that today if a male has a count of 18, 19, 20 million, nothing to worry about. Okay, but we also, apart from the count, the sperm should also have a good motility. Okay, sperm should be motility. So I'm just showing you the old thing also, just because in case if they ask you. Okay, so if the older 50% sperms should have a very good motility, that was the criteria. Now the new is only 40% sperms. That means there's no point having lazy sperms. The sperms which are walking very 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 slowly, they are useless. Useless sperms, okay. Good sperm should have good speed. So 40% sperm should have a very good motility. Okay, and the last thing, please pay attention, even the sperm morphology should be normal. That means what am I saying is that the sperm, ek hi head ek hi tail, there should be only one head one tail. Suppose there are two heads, okay, two heads, okay, confused sperm, where do I go? One head wants to go this side, other head wants to go this side, where do I go? Confused sperm. Or there are two tails, okay, one tail is pushing this side, other tail is pushing this side, sperm udhar round round ghum raha hai. Okay, or there could be various abnormality, absent head, only tail is there, or absent tail. Okay, so various abnormal forms of the sperms could be there. Okay, double head, double tail, absent head, absent tail, all that. Okay, so old criteria, they said that at least 30% sperms should be morphologically normal. Now with the revised criteria, they said that only 4% sperms also, if they are morphologically normal, that is very good. Okay, so this is very very important, that we should know the new criteria as per WHO 2010, that the count should be at least 15 million per ml. Please remember this, very very important MCQ. So asking on the recent AIIMS exam, I told you total motility should be at least 40% or more, and 4% sperm should be morphologically normal. Okay, and this, I repeat, this is old criteria. Why I am just teaching you? Because in case if 15 is not in the option, you can mark 20. And if they tell you today minimum sperm count should be, okay, and if 15 is in the option, 15 million per ml, please mark that. But in case, just for us to knowledge, that old criteria was 20 million per ml. I told you 50% sperm should have a good motility, and 30% sperm should be morphological or normal. But as I keep on repeating, this is old criteria, so you should just know it for historical importance. But by and large, this is, please keep in mind, please remember these values, which are the new, at 15 million per ml should be the sperm count, 40% motility, and 4% sperm should be morphologically normal. Okay, this all we should keep in mind. Okay, now overall, just remember one thing, that just this, as I told, just an overview of the conditions, that if there is, what all will you do? Okay, what all will you do? That if it is a male factor, for male factor, the main treatment is IUI. If the count is decent enough, or sometimes even a donor sperm may be required, IUI donor in cases of complete azoospermia. Azoospermia means zero sperm count. And even for male factor, we require ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection. This is overall the treatment. Okay, so male factor most of the time will be treated by IUI. The intrauterine insemination, the count is very very less, then even IVF and ICSI may be required. Okay, our and female factors, the anovulatory factor and all that, PCOS will require, yes, ovulation induction. Okay, so with letrozole, clomiphene citrate, all the gonadotropins, all that's a very important discussion. Ovulation induction agents will be helpful when patient is not ovulating. Okay, drugs, oral medicine, and your IM injections are also available. And the tubal factor, what we require is either a surgery, tuboplasty may be required to remove the block, to remove the adhesions. But many times the tuboplasty is not successful or the tube is badly damaged, then the only option left is IVF, in vitro fertilization, or our test tube baby, as in layman's language. So for tubal factor, so IVF mainly was discovered because of tubal factors. Okay, it can also be from it. So this overview of the treatment, that anovulation, go for ovulation induction, tubal factors, either go for tuboplasty surgery, or if not IVF, male factors will mainly require IUI, and uterine factors, yes, will require, yes, surgeries, that I'll have to correct it by surgery. All this intrauterine adhesions, polyp, fibroid will have to be removed to make the cavity normal, and then the female can conceive. So this is a overview of various causes in male, various causes in female, which could give rise to infertility, and what you do. Of course, in detail, we have to discuss all these topics for you, because everything is an important MCQ and is also for an important short note. But this is a overview which will help you recollect in one glance what are quickly the causes of infertility and what broadly you do for what conditions. Okay. And the last thing, I request all of you to subscribe to the Unacademy course, and DRPUNIT10 is my code, and this code DRPUNIT10 will help you get 10% discount, okay, on the subscription of Unacademy. You can DRPUNIT10, okay, 10 is the code, DRPUNIT10 is the whole code, that will give you 10% off. You can take 3 months, 6 months, 1 year subscription depending on your requirement. So those who are interns appearing for the January exam can take a 6 months course, or whatever. Those who are final student can even go for longer course, 1 year, 2 year course. Okay, so DRPUNIT10, I request all of you to enroll with this code to get 10% off. And there, in detail, entirely, almost for 3 hours session on infertility, where all the male factors, female factors, in detail, IUI, IVF, so almost it's a big session where we discuss infertility in detail in 3 to 4 hours. This is just a brief overview for all the students to get an idea. Best of luck for all your examinations, whether it's MBBS or PG entrance. Best of luck to all of you. Thank you, students.